This program was produced by and first broadcast on Radio Kidnappers, a volunteer-based community access station. For more information, go to www.radiokidnappers.org.nz. Thanks to New Zealand On Air for making this program available through funding the Access Internet Radio Project.
You're listening to Radio Kidnappers, the voice of Hawke's Bay. This is the Acupuncture On Air program. Our pleasure, as always, to have in the hot seat Heiko from the Acupuncture Clinic in Hastings. How you going, Heiko?
I'm really good, Ken, and you? Isn't it another glorious, sunny Hawke's Bay day?
As we record this program, we're heading for certainly mid-20s, and we have a very special guest on the program. Heiko, I'd like to make you, you make the intros.
Yeah. Well, firstly, it's good morning to Angie Harding from Christchurch. Now, she is the national president of Acupuncture New Zealand, which is New Zealand's first major acupuncture organisation. Good morning, Angie. How are you?
Good morning, Heiko. And yes, we are definitely in New Zealand.
Yeah. Sorry about that Freudian slip there. It's just I've got my Australian passport in my bag because I'm actually off to China after this interview.
Yeah, so he's all excited. That's why he's making a few mistakes this morning. So, Ange, you're the national president of Acupuncture New Zealand.
And we've got a very special day today. It's actually the inaugural World Acupuncture Day. So, I'm sure you've got a few questions to ask her, Ken, about that.
Yeah, I have. I mean, why is that significant in New Zealand? Why should we have a World Acupuncture Day right here in good old NZ? Because, you know, probably most people, Ange, either haven't heard of acupuncture or never tried it.
Well, it's not just in New Zealand, and this is the very first World Acupuncture Day. And it is worldwide, it's not just in New Zealand. And it's important that these days recognise the United Nations General Assembly designates a number of international days to mark the important aspects of the human life and of history. And the United Nations specialist agencies like UNESCO can proclaim World Days. And UNESCO celebrates the UN International Days related to its field of competence. And in addition to other world days proclaimed by the organisation's governing bodies or other institutions. And this is our very first one being recognised by UNESCO.
Well, I think that's amazing in itself because at least now we can say UNESCO has actually acknowledged that acupuncture, maybe it possibly works if they recognised it.
That is a good point, I think, that you raised it. The fact that UNESCO have recognised it, why are our governments so reluctant to give it the nod, do you think?
Well, I don't think that the government now is reluctant. I think, as with anything, it's a process and it takes time. Sadly for us, it's taken 40 years and there's been many different governments. But I think we're now at the stage where the government is ready to walk with us and walk across that line because, you know, the international evidence is out there and they can see that it is time for this to happen. And, of course, with regulation, the most important reason to regulate any profession is actually for the safety of the patient. And I think that the government has now recognised that, you know, with bodies like ourselves and everything going to the ends of the earth to keep the safety of the patients, sure, that it's actually time that they stepped up as well.
Well, you say that the government is recognising it, but are they going to recognise it to the point where they'll allow, say, acupuncture in hospitals?
Well, I believe that's going to come with regulation as we're more recognised. I also know so many hospitals overseas. They did trials in four hospitals in Melbourne. They're in Stanford Children's Hospital. In America, they're going to have acupuncture in all hospitals. I believe it's by 2020. There will be at least one acupuncturist in every hospital.
Oh, that means New Zealand will have it in 2080.
Let's hope that our government's more proactive than that, yeah, and that our organisational bodies are more proactive than that and really actually follow it up and get in there and point out that, look, we are cost-effective. I mean, this is how Chinese medicine survived. China isn't a small country. We are very cost-effective for a treatment, and We also have ways of managing larger population groups as well.
Now, the other thing is, what's happening around the world for World Acupuncture Day? I mean, I know that we've taken that opportunity here for my normal my radio show. It just timed it quite well for it. But what about around the world? What else is the American Acupuncture Association doing, or World Federation of Acupuncture Societies? What's happening?
Well, we've currently got two members in Paris who are either still in or have just finished a meeting with the Executive Committee of the World Federation of Acupuncturists, and there's celebrations at the UNESCO building in Paris, which is where the main UNESCO building is. Now, the building itself is in the shape of the letter Y, having three arms, one being an education arm, one being scientific, and one being administration, which really is just like the acupuncture organisations throughout the world. And that's going to be open to the public, and it will highlight the medicine.
There's lots of world days. I mean, there's World Donut Day. There's World
I didn't
Hot
know
Dog
that
Day.
One.
Yeah, there is. There's every day there's a world day.
Did UNESCO approve World Donut Day or what?
No, they didn't. But there's World Asthma Day, and they are promoted heavily, as you are suggesting, Ange, but you don't see acupuncture promoted very heavily in New Zealand. Why is that?
I think just because it's, like you say, it's not as well known. There are probably more sufferers of asthma than there are acupuncturists. I would say there are definitely more sufferers of asthma than there are acupuncturists at this stage. So it's really the fact that more people are more aware of asthma. You know, it's a common illness that starts as a child. Whereas in China, it's probably a little bit the other way around.
Yeah.
Because more people are aware of the medicine. They go to acupuncturists from being those children for the rest of their lives to help their healing and actually to help them stay well.
Mm. It was actually an acupuncture and awareness week that brought Heiko to the station, and he hasn't left since that day.
I'm sorry.
But how do you think the acupuncture society or the profession has changed over the years that you've been involved or Heiko's been involved?
Oh, we've most definitely progressed. A lot of more of our members are now seeking further education by studying their masters and PhDs, and our research levels. Currently, the statistics show that they've superseded most other modalities' research as we help to make our medicine more understandable to the world. Because while we know it works, now we're doing the research and bringing out the research to prove it.
What I've noticed, for me, I think one of the biggest changes that's happened over the years that I've been in is the quality and the standard of the education. I mean, when I did it, it was like a four-year diploma course, and now it's basically a four-year bachelor's degree, and just the level of information is a lot more, and the intensity of the training. Remember the other day we spoke with Hamish Reid from Melbourne, and they do now very extensive training and assessment for all the musculoskeletal things, which is stuff that I never did, and now of course with the study in a bachelor's program that the students getting involved in research, that then just all this just keeps the profession growing and getting to a higher standard. Now, Ange, how many students do you know would we have in New Zealand that might be graduating now each year? Do we have any figures on that?
No, Heiko, to be honest, I'm not sure. There will be figures, but...
I know we've got colleges in Wellington and Auckland.
Yeah.
So I'm just wondering, the numbers up there must definitely be increasing.
The schools will have the numbers, and I regularly attend the graduations in Wellington and Auckland, but of course not all graduating students can attend, and so I would only be guessing, and I wouldn't even like to do that. But there's no doubt the profession is constantly growing, and I'm sure there's more numbers at each graduation I go to.
I wonder though, Angie, is there a problem within the profession that anyone can hang up a shingle and say they're an acupuncturist, can't they? They don't have to go through a university. I could hang my shingle up and just get some needles and stick them in people and say I'm an acupuncturist. Is that a problem for you?
At this stage, it is a problem. Believe with government regulation, you won't be able to say you're an acupuncturist. However, there are those out there doing lesser forms of acupuncture, for lack of a better phrase. Dry needling, for example, that's part of our acupuncture. However, that is something we do in conjunction with everything we've learned in our 4 years, and that is what you need to actually be a safe and effective needler. You don't want to be visiting someone who's done a weekend course.
Yeah, indeed. Exactly. Now, I'm probably much like yourself, Heiko is such a proponent of acupuncture that there's nothing. Nothing that it can't treat.
Except itchiness in between the toes.
Yeah, you had to go to the doctors and get some cream for that. But I wonder, with chronic diseases like Parkinson's, strokes, MS, arthritis, that sort of stuff, they're ongoing diseases, aren't they? And the problem is that acupuncture can be quite expensive. Is that another reason that people might turn away from it?
Well, I think that's a perception. You know, every time they go to the doctors, they might be paying $50 or $60, or the government might be subsidising it. But you see a doctor for 15, 20 minutes at best. Most acupuncturists, we work on a 45 to 60 minute scale. I know that the majority of my patients that walk through the door are here for 60 minutes, mm-hmm. and some longer. And particularly those patients, the stroke, the MS, the arthritis, the Parkinson's patients, they actually can be in my clinic for anything up to 90 minutes. So it's really perception about the cost. It is actually cost effective when you consider you're with us for that long and you're still only paying perhaps $80 for an hour session.
Yeah, no argument.
Yeah, I look at it, I slightly agree with Ken there, because the thing is, you know, you go to the doctor, you don't go to the doctor twice a week, and you see, and this is a problem that I find with some of these chronic conditions. But I look at that, there are ways around that. If we could get regulation and then some level of help or funding from the government, I mean, we could have special community clinics, you know, for these chronic patients, and have what's called like a multi-bed arrangement that would make it extremely cost-effective, and these patients wouldn't have to see a private practitioner and pay a private consultation each time. I think it could be very, very cost effective, but we're a little bit away from that.
I wonder, and as the national president of Acupuncture New Zealand, are you in constant, not every day, of course, but are you often talking to the Minister of Health to sort of try and get acupuncture integrated into the health system so you can get subsidies?
The minister himself, no, but people at the Ministry of Health, yes, we are constantly talking with them. Currently about regulation and making us practitioners under the Health Practitioners Competency Assurance Act, because without that there will be no funding for us. And of course the sad thing is there's never enough money.
Yeah, and this is what that's
the sad thing. There's never enough money, and we don't want to pay more taxes. So it's like, do we want a better health system? Do we need to pay more taxes to get it? Or are we just going to go with the status quo? And so that can be a real issue, you know. And I mean, the nurses not getting paid enough in the strikes, the overworked doctors, the waiting lists for surgery, all those things tell us there's not enough money for healthcare in New Zealand. However, I did recently do a rough working out that if you actually we don't just treat illness as acupuncturists, we actually treat wellness.
Yes.
And if everybody in New Zealand was going to an acupuncturist every 6 weeks to remain well, it would cost less per year than the current annual health budget.
All right. That'd be an interesting research project.
I wonder,
it
Andy,
would be. I'd love it if we could find a student or a member who was happy to take that one on board.
I wonder, Andrew, what do you think needs to be done? I mean, if Heiko wasn't one of our clients, for want of a better word, one of our broadcasters, I wouldn't have had a clue that it was Acupuncture Awareness Week. What do you think that your organisation needs to do to make acupuncture aware in the public's mind that, hey, you know, if I feel sick, I think, okay, I'm going to the doctor. But I need to think, hey, I might go to the acupuncturist as an alternative. What do you need to do as an organisation?
Well, we need to, and we are doing this with the research, showing that we can treat these illnesses. We need to also help New Zealanders get into the mindset, when they're healthy, of staying healthy.
Yeah.
Don't wait for the flu to come.
Sure.
go and get some immunity boosting treatments from your acupuncturist.
But I know that
Chinese medicine practitioner. Yeah.
You've got about 700 acupuncturists in New Zealand, and I know Heiko. He's he's a machine when it comes to promoting acupuncture in Hastings. Is that what you find throughout your members? I mean, are they all machines like Heiko that they're just constantly promoting, or do they need to get behind it more as well?
Well, all our members need to get behind it, but I think for a lot of members, a lot of the time we're actually butts up and heads down, yeah, just getting on and trying to do the job as best we can, given the circumstances we find ourselves in New Zealand. And we are very busy, and promotion takes time, and it takes time away from treating patients, which is why we all became practitioners.
Indeed.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'd love to see one day that, you know, that we can have a show like this, but actually like on, you know, Good Morning Auckland or one of those morning shows on TV. So that's my plan, Andy, that Ken and I were going to have a... take over the be on air every morning on TV, but I think we're getting up towards the end of our
of our
show
now. And Heiko normally ends the show on a pretty stink song, but I understand you've got better taste than him, so what are you going to play for us? But before we get to the song, just remind our listeners, Ange, if we want to come and see you for any acupuncture, tell our people where you are, or if you want to get hold of your organisation to talk to you about it, how do we do that?
Well, I'm in Christchurch. I've got the Palms Chinese Medicine Centre in Shirley, and I'm sure you can find me online and in the phone book. And our organisation, our head office phone number is very simple. It's 0800 Acupuncture. And I think Heiko will be able to put these details in the section of the YouTube.
Yeah, I'll put
that
up in the comments of the YouTube so that people can ring the office direct and then find an acupuncturist that's closest to them. But anyway, let's get your song, Ange, you know.
Oh, absolutely. With the great Bryan Adams coming to New Zealand, my favourite song of his, which I'd like you to play, is Everything I Do.
Especially for you, here it is. You look after yourself, Angie. We'll talk to you again another time.
Yeah, next year, all right?
Great, thanks for having me.
Take it easy, bye-bye.
Take care now.
Look into my eyes, you will see what you mean to me. Search your heart, search your soul.
Not
know it's true. Everything I do, oh, I do it for you.
This program was produced by and first broadcast on Radio Kidnappers, a volunteer-based community access station. For more information, go to www.radiokidnappers.org.nz. Thanks to New Zealand On Air for making this program available through funding the Access Internet Radio Project.